But you want to remember that when Elijah thought he was alone, there were 7,000. See, God's people are not necessarily on display. And I want to assure you that there are people around you, somewhere, there are people around you that are like this. They're like this. And they are people who have seen through all of the baloney that is thrown at us from the world, and they just have realized, this is it. This is it. This is good. See, now, the ordinary person, when they approach this, they look at it and say, ah, man, you don't know my relatives. They say, give unto him that asketh of thee, and from him that would borrow thee, turn not away. I have people that test me on this, by the way. I have people that write me letters and say, would you give me $500? I had one that did that, and I sent him $300 because that's all I had. He sent it back, and he said, I just wanted to see if you could do it. Now, you see, I felt I should do that. I would not do that under every circumstance. No. Because you see, I didn't say I wouldn't do it if you asked me. But you see, the point is this, that this is not a legal system. These are illustrations of a certain kind of person. And one of the things about that person is they will make judgments as to whether or not they do it or not. They're not going to say to the person for whom they have carried the load a mile, and that's as far as the guy wants to go. They're not going to say, well, you know, I have to carry this a second mile because Jesus said to. Because they have judgment. Where does that judgment come from? It comes from love. So, for example, if I owe money on my electrical bill, I'm not going to give that money to someone else. Now, you say you wouldn't? Well, I don't know. I would have to think about it. I might. But I'm not going to stiff the electric company to support my benevolence. So we have to make judgments. But let me assure you, there are people around you who know this. Let me tell you, there's a conspiracy about this. We don't talk about it. It's like guidance. You know, I have a book on guidance. And people who receive guidance outside of your kind of context, basically, it's almost like they've seen a UFO. They don't talk about it with people because they think you're crazy. God spoke to you, right? There's a lot of things we don't talk about. This is one of the things we need to talk about. And one reason why we don't talk about it is because we feel so guilty. Like even in most of my context, you know, is in the university. And most people there are either marginal Christians or not Christians at all. And yet they know about this and they feel guilty about it. They kind of laugh about it. Yeah, oh yes, going to turn the other cheek. Yeah. But they don't think of it as reality. Now, how are we going to get into it? How are we going to get the proper order into it? Let me give you this picture to work from for a few minutes. And let's just review now Colossians 3. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things that are where? Above. I suppose that means something. Where Christ sitteth on the right hand of the Father. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. That's where your life is. That's what Paul means in Ephesians when he talks about being seated with him in the heavenlies. The heavenlies are not beyond Jupiter or even the moon. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then you shall appear with him in glory. That is glorious. You will be glorious. You will appear with him in his glory. And then Paul goes on to say, put off the old person and put on the new person. And you remember those verses, and because of time, I don't want to read the whole thing, but you remember what goes with the old person. The old person is very definitely here, isn't he? Right? Fornication. That seems to be at the head of everyone's list. That's realism. Hatred. Filthy thought, language, all that. That's the old guy. Put him off. And one can say, well, I'm willing, Lord. But it won't happen. Putting off the old person is for you to do. Put on the new person. Same thing. Putting on the new person that is has all of these wonderful attributes that we read over and over in the scripture, that's something for us to do. And the question that we all have to face is, what is our plan for doing it? What is our plan for doing it? Now then, this triangle tries to do justice to all the factors that are involved. I put at the top the action of the Holy Spirit, new birth. Gifts of the Spirit, fruit of the Spirit, anointing, baptism, filling, all that language. That's right up at the top, because without that, we're dead. We're dead in trespasses and sins. Then you have also ordinary events of life. This is where it happens. It does not happen when you go to church, though a part of it may happen there. It happens in the ordinary events of life. I see, that's where the strain is put on this, isn't it? This is church. This is life. Temptations, trials, that's just the ordinary stuff. That's what we all fret about, worry about, and think over. Count it all joy when you fall into all kinds of trials. Why in the world? Why? Because if you accept them in faith that God is going to show his hand, he will show his hand. If you don't, if you decide to chew your pills instead of swallow them, it's going to be a tough day. And you won't get much out of it. But if you accept your trials and you say, praise God for these trials, you're going to be filled full of peace and joy. And you're going to see the hand of God. And what does James say will happen in that passage? You remember? You become perfect. I didn't say it. Where will you become perfect? In the trials of ordinary life. So now here's another general rule. Just like you, I said in the earlier hour, try never to hurry. Try to live a life in which you never hurry. So I want to say now, try to live a life in which you are constantly thankful for everything that comes. You say, how can I do that? Again, you can only do that if your expectation is of the Lord. If your expectation is of the Lord, then everything that comes to you, from cancer to a flat tire, you will say, this is the place that I will know the deliverance of God. I will see that God is here. And the peace and the joy will flow with that. Now, of course, these things are related, aren't they? Where does hurry come from? Hurry basically comes from trying to deal with a mess of stuff we're certainly not thankful for, doesn't it? And we're pretty sure God is not running the show. So this corner down here now is important. Okay, so you have two corners, the action of the Holy Spirit, absolutely fundamental. Now don't think that these are things, I've separated them, but they're never separate. This is where the action of the Holy Spirit happens, right down there, right? It isn't like you have a little dab of one, and then you have a little dab of the other, and you have a little dab of the other. None of them work by themselves. If the only thing you have is the action of the Holy Spirit, you're not going to be good for much of anything. Maybe good for dying. You're ready to die. Okay. You're not going to be ready to live. You remember Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing, and you can put it down, that if you do nothing, it will be without him. You can just put it down. You do nothing, it'll be without him. And we just have to get over this thing about grace and works. That should have been dealt with. That's dealt with. Let's put it out of the way. We don't earn anything. This project isn't earning. It's what kind of people are we becoming? What kind of people are we becoming? See, what you get out of your life, basically, and what God get out of your life is the same thing. It's the person you become. And that's what we're talking about. And then on this side, finally, you have the planned disciplines for putting on new bowels or guts. Put on new guts. That's a reference to the inside. That's where life comes from. These are planned activities that we use to enable us to receive the fullness of the kingdom in such a way that it pervades our body, our soul, that it dominates our social context. Todd, you were talking about Billy Graham. One of the things, when you come into that man's presence, it's a different kind of situation, isn't it? See, presence is something you should count on having. The primary body of evangelization in the world is your body. The primary instrument of evangelization is your body, which is called the temple of the Holy Spirit. It will modify your social context. A long time ago, I began to notice that people like in the university. Like, we had one guy who would just get into mad fits and just go crazy. He never did that around me. I never saw it. I was chairperson, and I had to deal with it. In general, people just behave differently around you, frankly. And now, I had some times, like, for example, he came in one time, and he wanted to manage something. He was a big manager deal, you know. He was one of these people that liked to cause the appearance that everything was being done by consensus, though he was actually running it. You ever meet people like that? We're going to get together now and we're going to have consensus. And turns out everything is what he wants done. he suggested a way of doing this at once. I said, that really wouldn't be truthful. He said, oh, walked out. But see, most people assume you will lie. When you stop cooperating with evil, you suddenly restructure your whole world. That's true in every aspect of life. And often in our churches, we need to do that because things are not going in this way. Often in our churches. And basically what we need to do is just stand in the spirit of transparency, truthfulness, loving kindness, not trying to manipulate or manage anything, just being Christ, woman or man in that context. And we don't need generally to jump on people and straighten them out. I rarely find anyone who is wrong about something that doesn't know it. And that is a part of Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, is to just lay that down and let that go. So now, these planned disciplines, which we'll start now and finish up later, I want to just give you a list of them. There's nothing sacred about this list. But it, on the other hand, it has some pretty important things on it that have been tried and proven true for a long while. They are practices that are in the Bible. I've given you a general description here. Again, I'm sorry about the thing, but I'll read it. Discipline, some activity in my power that enables me to accomplish what I cannot do by direct effort. Some activity that is in my power that enables me to do, to accomplish what I cannot do by direct effort. So what did Jesus say to his guys? Watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. Watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. Now, in their case, they were not even able to watch and pray. And you have very significant words in there, like they were sleeping for sorrow. They were depressed, maybe a little angry, certainly confused. So sometimes, and indeed, I'll take up on this when we start again, but I want to just get into it a little ways. You find that some of these disciplines are more fundamental than others. From my background, the big disciplines were really study and prayer. Those are the things that you were supposed to make work if you were really serious, and that would empower you to witness and win souls. And I'm not making fun of that. That's very important material, and it was to me. But what I found was, as a preacher in a Southern Baptist context, that almost no one was studying their Bible. A lot of people were talking about it. Almost no one was doing it. Prayer, much the same way. And generally speaking, I find that people feel less competence in prayer than almost any other thing. Now, I know that you have a different emphasis, and thank God for that. But many, many, in most Christian circles, they just don't know what to do with it. They don't know what prayer is. It doesn't make any sense to them. And so they just can't do it. So in some cases, some of these disciplines, we need to return to the more fundamental ones. And I think the two most fundamental ones are solitude and study. Solitude is the primary discipline for the spiritual life. And we're going to talk about that. We need to stop now because we have a lunch break. And when we come back, I'm simply going to talk about these individual disciplines. Some of them won't be able to get over all of them. And how they affect the change that allows these two arrows to come together. That allows us to walk simply and strongly in the reality of Christ. Thank you very much, Todd.